All right, Alan Gingerich here with you. I'm the hunt director for the hunting ops department at United Kennel Club. I'm here with Eric Yant. And Eric, today I want to talk about some tips for good judging. I think there's probably nobody better here than to discuss that this morning. So I appreciate you being here. So let's just get right into it. And so let's talk about number one, introductions. We're talking about judge meeting up with the cast. And it's absolutely necessary for the cast to assemble prior to casting their hounds to discuss some of the semantics on how their hunt will run. And this is your chance as the judge to take control of the cast right from the start. It's also the sportsman's way of getting acquainted with those he will be competing against for during this hunt. And this is a time to lay down your ground rules, give every participant the opportunity to ask questions of you, the judge, the guide, and make any statements about their dog.
Absolutely. It is very important because one of the big questions is, hey, do you strike on a squeak? I think that's number one. And you got to get that out of the way early because, you know, you don't want people changing that throughout the cast. So
yeah, and in a separate podcast, you and I talked about some of the new rules. We talked about communication with when we're going to plus strike points and things like that. Communication. This is a good opportunity for the judge to talk to the cast about things like that.
Introduce yourself. Yeah. Not everyone, you know, is getting to know each other. So. Yeah. That's good.
Yeah, make a nice
get your names out of the way. Yeah,
exactly. Number two, acknowledge calls. Let me back up a little bit. These tips here, I actually pulled from an old magazine that were written back in the middle 90s that Todd Kellum wrote, and we'll give him his due credit for it. And I kind of stole it from him, and I thought, man, they still work 100% today. And I pulled them out of the magazine, and that's where they came from here. So number two, acknowledge calls. Many misunderstandings are prevented on casts whose judge acknowledges called positions. It can be with a simple gotcha, or as involved as repeating the strike position and the dog's name after they called it. It lets other handlers in the cast know where they stand and assures them a called position was heard correctly, so that in the event a call is to be questioned, it can be done so immediately.
Yeah, you have to do this afterwards. I mean, this is an absolute must to me because you hear a bunch of people yell their dog's names like, okay, Alan, I got you first. I got you second, you third. No, I was second. He was third. I'm like, oh, okay. And everyone's in agreement. Everyone's right there. So you have to say it before you write it down, acknowledge that person. So you get the order right.
Yeah.
You don't just write it down and move on.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and leave it open to, hey, where did he strike and did a little of this or that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, just make it known right away. Just all part of good judging.
Yeah. And that's simple.
Why we call this tips for good judging.
Yeah.
Number three, addressing badgering. This is a sport, and from time to time, we may get down on ourselves or our hound. And that does happen sometimes.
Absolutely.
It's not going well for us out in the cast. Do not let that fact justify the problem of badgering the judge or other cast members. The best advice here is not to let it slide until it becomes an outright confrontation. Address the problem, then move on. Fair and impartial judges should not hesitate to use Rule 6 when it becomes necessary. Rule 6, we're talking probably about like unsportsmanlike conduct and things of that nature.
This is, you know, you just can't let people get out of control in the cast. And if you let them get away with a little bit here, a little bit there, hour into the cast, it could escalate into a bad situation. Thankfully, you just don't see this very often.
Yeah,
you might have your little argument or whatever, but you got to stop it.
Yeah, this is kind of hitting on somebody that's kind of just having a bad day. Things aren't going well. Just kind of like, oh man, you know, just kind of, you know, kind of a lot of negative.
Absolutely.
You know, and this is kind of make sure judge is not letting this get out of hand.
Because stuff like this could easily stop a new person from coming to hunts.
Mm-hmm.
They have one bad cast, or a young kid has one bad cast, and all of a sudden we just lost a participant. Like, well, if this is what it's about, I'm not coming. And that's not what it's about. It doesn't happen very often. Some of your bigger hunts, people, you know, might get out of hand. But just stop it right away.
Yeah. Yep. Number four, keep running totals. A good judge keeps the total score column up to date when it is convenient to do so. We don't see this a whole lot, kind of, you know, maybe kind of, but it's not a bad idea, really. If yep. not after the scoring of each turn loose, this system has been proven to reduce math errors and allows each handler in the cast ample opportunity to know how the cast stands at all times.
Absolutely. About every cast I'm in, at some point, someone will ask, hey, can I see the score? So if you have it already filled out,
yeah,
it's easy.
I think I see it more today, too, than we used to in the old days.
Sure.
Yeah. After each turn loose, before you cut dogs again, judge stands there and kind of goes over everything.
Goes over.
And, yeah.
Yep.
What just happened. This is where everybody is, and it just keeps everybody up to there's
it
nothing.
It eliminates confusion.
Yep. Number five, make timely but not snap decisions. I think this is a good one. Don't let the pressure of a confusing situation get the best of you. We all face scoring questions in situations that we are unsure of. Take a minute if you need to so that a unique situation can be thought out and scored appropriately. It's harder to make corrections than it is to score it correctly the first time. By the same token, do not delay decisions unnecessarily. Confusion and problems can at times become compounded the longer you wait before making a call.
Absolutely. Because if you flip-flop your decisions, that's just causing problems. So if you're unsure at the moment, split-track situation, something like that, just take a second, think about it, flip over your scorecard if you need to, and make your decision. And, you know, it's okay to talk to the other cast members. Maybe they can help you understand the situation because, hey, as a judge, I've been doing it for a lot of years. It doesn't mean I don't get confused at times. You're like, oh, wait, okay, I know the rule, but I might not be thinking it correctly.
Yeah.
So someone saying it back to me, like, oh, okay, yep, I got it now. Okay, yeah. Here's what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
This is my ruling.
Oh. Yeah. And that's a good one. Something we've talked about before on other podcasts, you know, don't overthink things. Sometimes, like you just said, sometimes you just got to flip that card over again to just make sure I've got it right.
Yep.
But yeah. Number six adds on to that, what we just talked about. Stick by your decision. If you have followed number five above, be clear and confident with your decision. Nothing undermines a judge's authority quicker than admitting you are in doubt or wavering in your decisions. If you have made what you feel is the fairest decision you can make, there is no need to offer the opportunity to have the call questioned. Explain your decision. If need be, answer a question. If need be, then bring it to a close and move on.
So this can kind of go back to what I just mentioned in the previous one. This is not the time when you want to ask the other cast members all their opinions. If you know the correct ruling, you got to make your decision right then and stick to it.
Yep.
You can't, well, this guy's, oh, my dog was close enough. We need to score him. What do you think? Well, I don't know. That dog was too far away.
Yeah.
That's just going to cause problems because then they're going to want you to do that every time.
You've opened yourself up to
absolutely
for debating scoring.
So if you know the right ruling, you know what you want to do, say it and do it. Make your decision and move on.
Yep.
And if someone doesn't like it, they put a question on there.
That's right. You know, follow the procedures.
Yeah.
There's procedures in place to deal with it. You know, sitting there and arguing, debating it for the next 5 to 10 minutes is not one of those.
Yep.
Stick to your decision. Number seven, be firm and fair. Though hunts are intended to be fun activities to do with your hound and fellow houndsmen and women, most handlers agree they would rather hunt with a strict judge than one who cuts up and lacks the seriousness to keep a cast in check. There's a good time to joke and a time to be serious, and you need to use good judgment. It should go without saying that failure to be less than fair undermines the whole concept of our honor rules.
You just got to keep it the same every time you make a decision. Once again, going back to what I just said,
yeah,
you can't keep asking the whole cast opinion.
Yeah.
You gotta make your decision, stick with it, mm-hmm. be firm.
Yeah.
And the fair part is, oh man, it's my dog. Did he just miss that line by himself? Yeah, he did. So make your decision. You can't determine it by if it's my dog, your dog, majority of the dogs. You got to make your decision on what's right.
Yeah.
It's that simple.
Yeah, and judging is should never be a benefit yourself. Maybe
correct.
The only thing that it might benefit is that you're going to run it by the rules that maybe
yep.
that somebody else may not have, but that's the only benefit you should ever have.
You just can't look at it. How does it affect me or the other people? What's right?
Yeah.
What's wrong?
Doesn't matter. You judge dogs. Roy Swofford used to always say, just judge dogs.
That's
score dogs.
That's a simple put. Simply put right there.
Doesn't matter who's or what. It's just score dogs.
Absolutely.
Yep. Number 8 kind of goes with that number 6. Be consistent. You have to be consistent with the manner in which you apply the rules. If you start out being lenient for one, you have to be lenient for them all. To start out lenient and end up strict is only asking for trouble and confrontations. And the other thing that I would add to this is I know sometimes you can be too lenient to where you have no control at all.
Absolutely. And I've seen this cause a lot of problems. I think this is where people get upset and they, oh, well, back at that first track, you said this, and now in this situation, you're changing it.
Yeah.
You can't do that. You start off that way. It's just goes back to a dog that you strike on a squeak.
Yeah.
You strike them on a squeak here, you're striking them on a squeak or, you know, later in the hunt.
Yeah.
You got to stay consistent. Yeah. And that's what makes a good judge.
Yeah.
What makes a bad judge is the ones that are not consistent. And it's not
starting out lean and ending up strict.
Yeah.
Doesn't work very well.
That makes a good judge. Yeah. It really does.
Yeah. And sometimes, you know, you get caught giving breaks or whatever, and breaks only lead to, you know,
more problems.
If you start handing out breaks, everybody deserves breaks, and that's no good.
Yep.
Number 9, don't take questions personally. One of a handler's basic rights on a hunt is the right to question a call that was made or a call that should have been made but wasn't. That doesn't mean they can badger a judge with a barrage of questions and insinuations, but it does mean that they have the opportunity to disagree. Don't take it personally when somebody does. Answer the question, state your position, discuss it briefly, and then move on. They wish to question mark a call after a cast vote, put it down without comment. Leave it at that. Take it back.
That's pretty simple. Don't get upset just because someone disagrees with your call. You know, hey.
We're talking about the judge here.
Yeah.
You know, don't take it. Don't take questions personally.
You know, we're not perfect.
Yep.
We try to be.
Yeah, that's
but
right.
But we're not. Hey, if someone questions something, you vote on it in the field, and 3 people think it's, you know, the opposite of what you said, that's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Nope. And then finally, one other one I think is a good one. Number 10, have a positive attitude. Seems like the attitude of the judge sets the attitude of the cast right from the start. The fact that the host club has asked you to judge is a compliment. It means that your peers consider you to be honest and capable. Yes, it's more responsibility than simply handling a dog, but the future of the sport relies on honest, capable judging. Without it, the sport will lose disgruntled new hunters and experienced hunters who get fed up with the problems caused by unfair judging. Remember, the more people we get started on the right foot with the right attitude about the sport and with a proper understanding of the rules, the more enjoyable it will be for everyone.
Oh, yeah. And you know, we all do this because we love to compete, but I love to do this. I like to see other people's dogs. Hey, a dog does a good job on something, tell them. There's nothing wrong with that. Yeah. Hey, your dog did a heck of a job there.